Thanks so much. It's really a privilege and an honor to be here to speak at the National Academy and be with all of you today. So I'm going to talk about work in our research group that's representative of a broader shift in the social sciences over the past few years. So if you look at members of the National Academy, traditionally in the behavioral and social sciences, a number of the members have made fundamental theoretical contributions, formulating quantitative or qualitative theories that have really been the building blocks of economics, psychology, sociology, and other related fields. Traditionally, though, social scientists lack the data to test between different theories and understand which theories and which models were most relevant in the real world. Recently, thanks to the availability of data in a variety of forms, especially the rise of big data, which you hear a lot about in the context of Silicon Valley and companies like Google and Amazon improving the products they offer through modern data sets, the fields of social science, I think, are becoming increasingly empirical, and you will see that reflected in the members of the Academy inducted in this class, and I expect going forward as well. So I'm going to give you one illustration of how modern data, I think, is allowing us to transform our understanding of social science and inform policymaking by talking about the American dream, which is, of course, a multifaceted, complicated concept that means different things to different people. I'm going to distill it in this first slide here by focusing on a simple statistic that we can measure systematically in the data, which is one way that people have thought about the American dream traditionally, that is, what fraction of children go on to earn more than their parents did, measuring both kids' and parents' incomes in their mid-30s and adjusting for inflation. And we're looking at that data based on the year in which children were born, starting with children born in the 1940s, where you can see that it was a virtual guarantee that you were going to achieve the American dream of moving up relative to your parents. 92% of children born in 1940 in America went on to earn more than their parents did. If you look at what has happened over time, you see a dramatic fading of the American dream, such that for children born in the 1980s, only 50% of American kids go on to earn more than their parents did. Now, this trend, I think, is not just of interest to economists. It's, of course, a profound change in our economy. But it's also more broadly, I think, what underlies a lot of the frustration that people around America are expressing in political outcomes and in social context more broadly. So motivated by this trend, in our research group at Harvard, we're motivated by figuring out essentially what is causing this fading of the American dream and what might we be ultimately able to do to restore children's chances of climbing up. Now, when you just look at the data at a macroeconomic aggregate level like this, of course, there are lots of things changing over the past half century. And with that set of data points, it's difficult to figure out exactly what the key drivers of this trend might be. So this is where the power of having much larger data sets comes in. We use data covering essentially the entire US population drawn from anonymized tax and census records that allows us to disaggregate this national phenomenon to a much finer level. So in this map here, we're now disaggregating the national data and looking at 20 million children who were born in the 1980s who we linked to their parents, to then look at the geography of upward mobility within the United States. So let me first describe to you what we're plotting on this map. It's a very simple measure of upward mobility. We're taking kids who grew up in families at the 25th percentile of the national income distribution, that is families earning about $25,000 a year, and we ask, where did these children themselves end up in adulthood in the income distribution? How much are they earning on average when they're 35 years old? We divide the US up into 740 different metro and rural areas, take the set of kids who grew up in each of those areas, and compute that upward mobility statistic that I just described. Now, the map is colored so that red areas represent areas with lower levels of upward mobility, and blue-green colors represent areas with higher levels of upward mobility, where kids from low-income families tend to rise up higher in the income distribution. So start by just looking at the scale in the lower right of this map. You can see that in the dark red colors, places like Charlotte, North Carolina, for example, when you start out in a family earning $25,000 a year, one generation later, the mean income is still about just $26,000 a year. So very little mobility across generations. In contrast, if you look at the center of the country in the blue colors in Nebraska, for example, You see values above $45,000 a year. So kids starting out in families at the same level of income, their incomes have risen dramatically across one generation. So in this big map, you can see the broad regional variation for yourself. There are much higher rates of mobility in the center of the country than in the southeast. Many cities in the industrial Midwest, like Cleveland, have very low rates of upward mobility. Now, it turns out, though, that it's not just that rates of social mobility vary at a broad level across different parts of the United States. They actually vary at an extremely local level. So in our most recent work, we've been constructing similar statistics by census tract for every census tract in America. So census tracts are small geographic units used by the U.S. Census Bureau, where they divide the United States into 70,000 different neighborhoods, each of which has about 4,000 people. And here we're showing you the same data that I showed you before at a national level within the city of Seattle, where we're doing some work, which I'll come back to in a second. And so you can more generally go to a website where this is publicly available. We've constructed an interactive online tool called the Opportunity Atlas. So if you just look up the Opportunity Atlas online, you can type in any address you like and look at how children who grew up in a particular neighborhood ended up doing in adulthood. So looking at this map in Seattle, the first thing to note here is that the spectrum of colors that you see on this map is exactly the same as the spectrum of colors that you saw at the national level. So that is to say, you can go 2 miles down the street within Seattle, say from the central district, where you're seeing rates of upward mobility that look comparable to what we were seeing in Charlotte, North Carolina, or in much of Alabama, to if you go down to a place like Normandy Park, you see rates of upward mobility that look higher than what we were seeing in Iowa. So these differences in terms of children's chances of climbing the income ladder arise at an incredibly local level. It's not just about broad regional differences. Now, naturally, the question of interest to us as academics and the question of interest to policymakers is what's driving these differences in kids' outcomes across these narrow areas, and what might we be ultimately able to do to increase upward mobility in the places that are in the red colors? So I'm going to show you a series of results that help us understand that question. So the first question to ask, I think, is this variation that we're seeing in these maps driven by the causal effects of neighborhoods, or is it about different people living in different places? So one hypothesis you might have is the types of people living in the center of Seattle might be different from the types of people living in Normandy Park, and maybe this is not fundamentally about the causal effects of place, but perhaps just about sorting. A different hypothesis is that if I take a given child and put that child in a red-colored part of the map or a blue-colored part of the map, I'm going to see different outcomes for that given child. So this, of course, gets to the root of getting at causation, and that has traditionally been a very difficult issue in the social sciences because, unlike some of the other fields you've just been hearing about, it is much harder for us to run experiments where we can determine, you know, we can randomly assign kids to different neighborhoods and see what happens to them in adulthood. So what I'm going to show you next is how we can take advantage of big data to try to approximate the experiments you would ideally run, and I think get quite close in terms of causal inference. So I'm going to describe a study in which we looked at 7 million families that moved across neighborhoods with children of different ages. And rather than getting into the statistical details of that study, I'm going to summarize what we find with a simple example. So let's imagine we take a set of families that move from the central district, where, as I just showed you in the map before, if you grow up there from birth, we see that children have average incomes in adulthood of $26,000 a year. And imagine a set of families that move from the central district to Normandy Park, where we saw much better outcomes for kids who grew up there from birth. So let's start by looking at families who move when their child is exactly 2 years old. So what we're going to do is track that child forward 30 years using the tax data, measure that child, those children's incomes on average when they're adults. And in this first dot here, you can see that kids who move when they're exactly 2 from the central district to Normandy Park end up having average earnings of about $39,000 a year when we're measuring their incomes in adulthood. Okay, so that's for the kids who move when they're exactly 2. Now we repeat that analysis for kids who move when they're 3, 4, 5, and so on. And what you see is a very clear declining pattern. The later you make that move from the central district to Normandy Park, or from a red-colored part of the map more generally to a blue-colored part of the map, the less of a gain you get. And if you move after you're in your early 20s, the relationship is completely flat and you get essentially no gain at all. So what do you see from this chart? I think there are three key lessons. First, you see that apparently places have a significant causal effect on children's long-term outcomes. It's not just that the people who live in the Central District are different from the people who live in Normandy Park, but apparently if you take a given child and move that child to a different place, you see really different outcomes. I think a particularly convincing piece of evidence that this reflects causal effects rather than differences in the types of families living in different areas is you can replicate this analysis looking at siblings within the same family. So imagine a family that moves with a 3-year-old and a 7-year-old. Remarkably, you recover the same curve if you compare outcomes across siblings within a given family, which really shows you that environment seems to have powerful effects above and beyond the effects a family itself might have. So that first result, I think, is very encouraging because it suggests that problems that seem somewhat intractable, like inequality and social mobility, actually the answer might lie just a few miles down the street, where if a child moves to a somewhat different neighborhood, you see really profound changes in that child's life outcomes. The second thing that you see is what really seems to matter is childhood environment rather than conditions in adulthood. It's moving as a kid that really seems to have a big impact on long-term outcomes. The third thing, which is related to that, is it's not just the very earliest years of childhood that seem relevant, but the entire course of childhood that determines later outcomes, right? So there's a lot of focus, as many of you will know, on early childhood interventions, and I think there's some evidence from neuroscience and other fields, which others here will know much better, that there may potentially be greater impacts of interventions at early ages. But what you can see here is, at least in a social and economic context, being in a better environment when you're age 10 instead of 15, moving to a better neighborhood when you're 10 instead of 15, continues to yield quite substantial gains. So environment seems to matter throughout childhood, which I think is an important lesson in understanding the processes that determine childhood development and is relevant for policy as well. So what I want to do in the remaining few minutes is transition from this set of research findings and show you how this type of research can inform economic policy making. And so just as one step in the process to getting to that, you might be wondering, you know, I've shown you that neighborhoods seem to differ greatly in the chances they offer kids of rising up. So what is it about the neighborhoods that are in the blue colored parts of the map? Surely it's not just random that they tend to have better outcomes. Do they have certain systematic characteristics that we might be able to learn from in trying to figure out how we replicate those outcomes elsewhere? And so it turns out if you look at a variety of theories that sociologists and economists have considered over the years, you find that there are indeed certain systematic factors of places that have high levels of upward mobility. They tend to have lower poverty rates, as you might imagine. They have more resources. They tend to have more stable family structures, so they tend to have more two-parent families in particular. They tend to have greater social capital. So if you look at measures of the extent to which low-income families are connected to high-income families, the social network tends to be more tightly connected in areas that have higher levels of mobility. And finally, as you might expect intuitively, they tend to have better schools. So how can we use this type of information now to inform the types of policies that shape inequality and mobility in our society today? So given what I've shown you, in our research group, we're focusing on three main approaches to increasing upward mobility. The first is to try to reduce segregation. So if you think about the evidence I've shown you, it's that when we think about inequality, we should think about it at a very granular level, where there are sharp differences across local areas in kids' chances of rising up. And so if you think there's sort of a pipeline to opportunity in each of these different neighborhoods, and low-income people tend to be concentrated in neighborhoods that currently offer low levels of opportunity, one intuitive thing you might think of are policies that reduce segregation and help low-income families move to higher opportunity areas. So that's one potential class of solutions. A second potential class of solutions is to recognize that, of course, you can't possibly move everyone from one neighborhood to another. That's never going to be scalable. So you also need to figure out how you invest in places that currently offer poorer outcomes for children. What can you do in those places, perhaps improving the quality of schools, changing the nature of social capital, social connectedness, to improve outcomes in those areas? A third approach, recognizing that after age 18, the key touch point in terms of having an impact on kids is no longer childhood neighborhoods, but institutions of higher education, is to figure out how we amplify the impacts of our colleges on social mobility by increasing access for low-income kids to high-quality colleges and so forth. Now, I'm not going to have time to talk about what we're doing in each of these branches in detail. I'm just going to briefly give you an example, an illustrative example, from the first section. So in partnership with the Seattle Housing Authority and the Housing and Urban Development Agency, we've been looking at how the nation's affordable housing policies interact with the type of data we've been constructing to address intergenerational poverty. So just as a bit of institutional background, in the US, we spend about $45 billion a year on various affordable housing programs that are intended to desegregate cities and provide low-income families access to better neighborhoods. Now, if you look at how those programs actually work, here I'm giving you an example from the Housing Voucher Program, which provides rental assistance to about 2 million families in America to rent apartments wherever they'd like. And the black dots here show where families receiving housing vouchers in Seattle currently live. These are the most common locations where families receiving vouchers currently live in Seattle. And what you can see is that those dots tend to be clustered in the red and orange parts of the map. That is the lower mobility, lower opportunity parts of Seattle. So you might wonder, you know, why is that the case? These families in principle would be able to afford to live in some of the blue-green colored parts of the map. You know, is it that they don't want to live in those areas, or are there some barriers that might be preventing them from leasing units in those areas where we have clear evidence that their kids would do much better in the long run? So we've designed, in order to evaluate that question, a randomized controlled trial that has been implemented over the past year in Seattle, where we're helping families with housing vouchers move to higher opportunity areas using three approaches: by giving them simple information, by recruiting landlords to rent their apartments to these families, and by offering assistance in the housing search process to help these families find units in these higher opportunity areas. And the results from the study are not yet public, but I can just say that this appears to be remarkably effective. The fraction of families who end up living in higher opportunity areas as a result of a relatively low-cost set of interventions is dramatically higher. And now, in light of that evidence, you know, I was just down at the Housing and Urban Development Agency a couple of days ago here in DC, talking about how you might scale this type of program nationally, thereby making our $45 billion expenditure on affordable housing much more effective. So that gives you a sense of how we can go from this type of scientific research to having an impact on policy that might actually change the lives of millions of families. So in the last minute, I just want to show you a different angle on this set of issues that I think may be of particular interest to the National Academy and to this audience here. So the traditional argument for equality of opportunity is based on principles of justice, that everyone should have a shot at the American dream, no matter what their background. But I want to end by showing that improving opportunities for upward mobility can also be important purely from the perspective of economic growth. And so to illustrate that, I'm going to focus on one particular pathway to upward mobility that's particularly relevant here, which is innovation. So to do this, I'm going to show you some data on the lives of 750,000 patent holders in the U.S., where we've linked information on the universe of patent records in the U.S. to the tax data to study the lives of inventors. Now, patents are, of course, an imperfect proxy for innovation, as many of you here will know, but it's one quantitative indicator, and as you'll see, it's informative. So let's start with this chart here, which shows you your probability of having a patent or becoming an inventor versus parents' income. And what you can see is that there's an incredibly strong relationship between your probability of becoming an inventor and your parents' income. If you happen to be born to parents in the top 1% of the income distribution in the U.S., you are 10 times as likely to become an inventor as if you happen to be born to parents at the median. Now, one potential explanation for that pattern is that this is about differences in environment, schools, exposure, the types of things that I've been talking about here. A different explanation that we should at least consider from a scientific perspective is that maybe this is about differences in quantitative aptitude or intrinsic skill, where maybe kids born to parents at the top of the income distribution who must have been talented to get there, maybe they themselves are more likely to go on to do well and become inventors themselves. So one way to get at that question is to bring in another source of data. So here we're now looking at the same y-axis, the fraction of people who go on to become inventors, but now plotted against your third grade math test scores. And what you see here is that for kids born to parents in the top quintile of the income distribution shown in the green here, high income families, there's a strong relationship between your third grade math test scores and your probability of becoming an inventor. If you're at the top of your third grade math class, you're much more likely to become an inventor. But if you're from a lower middle income family, even if you're at the top of your third grade math class, there isn't that much of a gain. So that is to say, high scoring kids are much more likely to become inventors if they are from high income families. Or to put it more starkly, in the United States, it seems like to become an inventor, you need two things. You need to have high levels of aptitude, and you also need to be from a rich family. And so if you can look at it from that perspective, you can see that improving equality of opportunity is not just of interest from a social justice perspective, but potentially of great interest from the perspective of improving science, technology, and creating economic progress. And the magnitudes here are potentially quite large. So there's an important phenomenon of what we call lost Einsteins. So in particular, if we calculate that if women, minorities, and kids from low-income families were to invent at the same rate as high-income white men, you'd have four times as many inventors in America as you currently do. So I think the stakes here are quite large. So let me end by coming back to the chart that I started out with the fading American dream. I think one way that you can look at this is from somewhat of a pessimistic perspective that, you know, America is no longer the country that it once was, and this is due to a set of political and social forces that are very hard to control. But as I hope I've shown you here, I think you can take a much more optimistic view that through science and through a granular analysis of modern data, we can have an impact on this and many of the other defining social and economic challenges of our time. Thanks so much.